Thank you to the both of you for joining us. The pandemic has highlighted gender disparities. There have been numerous reports that have suggested that women have been the hardest hit during the pandemic. Jimmy, what is it going to take to help women thrive in Canada's labor market?
Yeah, so this has been one of the top concerns with this pandemic. It's just the distribution and how it's had a disproportionate impact on women. And I tend to look at core-aged women in particular. And for that specific group, the women aged 25 to 54, there's still a 2% shortfall versus pre-pandemic levels when you look at employment. And that's almost a double of the shortfall that you see for men in the same age group. Also, we know that the share of people working less than half their usual hours, that share is higher for core age women, 7.3% as of April, as opposed to 5.5% for men. So definitely, even though we've made some progress from the depths of the pandemic, there's still quite a bit of work to do. I think the biggest factor will be the reopening the economy, plain and simple. That will deal with the root cause, which is the lockdowns. And you should see when we're able to sort of function in some kind of normal, the demand for workers is going to increase, especially in sectors that still have very large shortfalls relative to levels of activity that we used to know prior to the pandemic. So those sort of non-essential, high contact sectors within services that tend to employ a disproportionate amount of women. So I think that's going to be the big factor here in the very near term. But we know also that there's some longer term initiatives such as childcare support. With the example set by Quebec 24 years ago, and now in the last federal budget, Chrystia Freeland decided that it was time for the rest of Canada to kind of catch up to that. So I think that's going to be very promising in terms of helping lifting labor force participation among women and in turn help lift Canadian potential GDP. But there's going to have to be more work to be done as well on closing the earnings gap, support for women entrepreneurs, the kind of initiatives that existed well ahead of this pandemic.
Kevin, we had decades of workforce gains. Will these losses be permanent due to the economic lockdowns?
Well, that depends. I mean, some of them could be permanent. And that I only say that because clearly some employers are going to bring in automation. They already have to get through the pandemic just by social distancing restrictions that were put in place. So obviously you respond to that. If you're running a business, you want to keep production going. So you're going to do what you need to do. Companies I've talked to have brought in automation to keep things going. And now they realize, well, you know what? I don't need to bring back my entire staff because I'm doing as much or more with fewer people. But to Jimmy's point, obviously, as the recovery continues to pick up speed, as we sort of we get back to where we were, a lot of these people are going to come back into the labor force. So that's key. But I think what we'll see is, and I mean, I talked about automation, and there's a dark side that comes along with automation. People start to worry about the robots and the machines taking over from the humans. Well, I mean, that happens in very specific circumstances, but what history tells us is that we keep looking for new ways to innovate, keep looking for new ways to make money, keep coming up with new ideas, and all these things tend to generate employment along the way. So as long as we get the economy rolling, we should get back to where we were, and as long as we make some of those structural changes, again, like Jimmy talked about around childcare and some of these other things, then there's every reason to think that we'll get employment back to levels that it was before.
Jimmy, let's go back and pick up on something that you had mentioned. The most recent federal budget, of course, introducing a child care plan, $30 billion over the next 5 years. You had also mentioned that Quebec came up with this plan 24 some odd years ago. Are we behind? Can we catch up?
Well, it's a great question. I think you know, we look at, for example, Quebec and the Educational Childcare Act, which was instituted in 1997. At the time when it was introduced, the female participation rate in Quebec was 4 percentage points lower than the rest of Canada. Today, it's 4 percentage points higher. You know, the Quebec policies, you can include, you can attach to that the parental insurance plans that came in to effect in 2006 to further reinforce labor force attachment. Those policies do offer, I think, a good template. They're understood to have boosted Quebec GDP by 1.7%. So 1.7% for Canada, that would be a big deal. But to your point, it's not something to expect overnight. It's going to take time. I think what was announced is just a start. To be sure, it's something that's very gradual. The goal is to bring childcare costs down to $10 a day, not tomorrow, but over a five-year period. We also know that there's important and very likely to be thorny negotiations with the provinces. Already Alberta and Ontario said the program was not suitable to their circumstances. And what's always been a difficult conversation between Ottawa and the provinces is national standards that condition funding. And there's certainly some of that with this project. And then you look into, you know, even if you solve that, you have capacity issues for all the praises that the Quebec program got. Building the capacity of the licensed daycare system proved to be much slower than hoped. Right to this day, 24 years later, there's still a significant lack of space. It makes the headline every day. So I think it's a great step taken by the federal government here. There's no doubt in my mind that this will help over time boost the economy's potential when we talk about a higher labor force participation and especially among women. But we have to be realistic. This is a multi-year, if not multi-decade endeavor.
Kevin, I've heard a few economists say it's no longer a social issue. It is part of the economic infrastructure, women in the labor force. How important is this child care plan to Canadians?
Well, I think it's huge. I'm going to pick up on where Jimmy left off, essentially. And he was sort of getting at the main worry about this is whether we can put this program together fast enough. And I think there is a risk here that the government has sort of set out the goal. 5 years from now, we'd like $10 a day daycare across the country without thinking through all that we're going to need to do to get to that point. And there's going to be a lot to do. As Jimmy said, there are capacity issues. We don't have enough daycare spaces on the ground. Surely those can be generated, but I haven't seen a lot of people talking about how exactly we do that. Another capacity constraint would be just the number of trained individuals who have the skills necessary to take care of all these children. Again, we can get there, but it's going to take some work, and haven't seen a lot of that sort of thinking on the table. Lots of people are out there thinking about it, but we're going to need to bring that together and really push that as hard as we can, because you know, we need to get more people. We need to crowd more people into the economy to push up our potential to grow. The easiest way, frankly, for us to do that is to take advantage of Canadian citizens who are sitting here who are frankly underemployed, and that's a big chunk of the women who are in the workforce or either are blocked from doing all they could do because they're taking care of children. Or simply they're trying to juggle careers and take time off, and then they're not in a position to reach their full potential. So yeah, it's a huge policy. We need to get it right.